Hello, my name is Bill Mann. Welcome to this video and pictorial tour of Newport Beach as it was during my formative years in the 50s and early 60s. The history of that period will live in the hearts and minds of those who were there. It will also be preserved in newspaper articles and a few books from locals who want to be historians. I relate to the later group. However, this is definitely not the history of Newport Beach. It's only a small part of Newport, as remembered by an impressionable young boy. Unfortunately, physical history is much more fragile. Many of the places I remember are no longer there, and others have been changed beyond recognition. But I'll try to describe them as they were then and as they are now. Thanks for joining me, and here's a preview of what you'll be seeing. At the center of my memories of Newport Beach is my grandparents' beach house. It served as the meeting place for many holidays and family reunions. During the summers, it was also a wonderful vacation spot for all the extended family members. The beach house was located at the left end of 28th Street with a nice view of the Newport Pier. My grandfather, Charles Robinson, his sister Harriet, and her husband, Ernest Fisher, built the house in 1921. The Robinsons, with their three young daughters, lived in various places, but they used the beach house as a summer getaway for family and friends. The tradition continued for the three Robinson granddaughters when they grew up and eventually had families of their own. My mother-to-be is the one on the left. Here's a picture of all the Robinson grandchildren in 1961. The good-looking one in the red shirt is yours truly. The beach house started off as a duplex. In the left unit, towards 28th Street, there was a kitchen, fireplace, bathroom, a living room in front, and three bedrooms upstairs. In the other unit, there were two bedrooms, a bathroom, den, kitchen, patio, and another living room. The wood wall between the two living rooms could be removed, and it usually was when I remember visiting for family parties. The beach house was remodeled often. In the spring of 1954, the 28th Street unit had the fireplace and kitchen made into a den. The den and kitchen in the other unit were redone into a much larger kitchen. In the fall of 1958, the oceanside entrance was removed, and the two living rooms were combined and extended a few feet towards the ocean with big bay view windows. A sliding glass door was installed between the living room and the patio. The den in the 28th Street unit was made back into another kitchen. A flexible accordion-style partition was installed to divide the living room in half so with a 28th Street unit could be separated as an apartment when needed. On the inland side, towards the alley, there was an old garage and carport. There were some open-air changing rooms and a shower for washing off the beach sand. There's nothing better than a warm shower after a cold ocean swim, but the shower drained directly into the alley. There were a lot of kids, and sometimes we'd flood the alley. So Grandpa had a simple sign, handwritten, inside the shower saying, "One shower, many kids, enough said." In the 1958 remodel, the old garage was demolished and replaced with a two-story attached garage, laundry room, inside beach shower, and even a special sink for cleaning fish. Upstairs, Grandpa added two more bedrooms and a bathroom. In one of the bedrooms, there was a door to the bedroom in the old part of the house, but the door was a little low. So Aunt June made us a nice sign to remind everyone to duck and not to bang their heads. This is what the new garage unit finally looked like when it was done. My grandparents enjoyed the beach house tremendously. Eventually, they moved there as their permanent home. After a while, they bought a place in Leisure World in Laguna Niguel. Perhaps they didn't like the activities, but I think they didn't get enough visitors. For whatever reason, they moved back to the beach house. Grandpa loved working in his garage and made wooden projects for every family member. Grandma always sat in her favorite chair, knitting things for the family and listening to the Dodgers on radio. We continued our family reunion at the beach house until they died in the mid-80s, and their daughters sold the property to a developer. I was there the sad day they tore the beach house down. I'll spare you the terrible sight of a bulldozer plowing through those memories and just show you the pictures of the vacant sand lot after the demolition was complete. This is the way the left end of 28th Street looks like today. The beach house was replaced with two nice single-family homes. 20 years ago, they sold for $1 million apiece. Today, they're probably worth five times that amount. However, the memories of the Robinson Beach House are priceless. I was born when Dad was in the Navy, so Mom and I spent a lot of time at the beach house with her parents and younger sisters. At about 1 year old, she said I was the cutest kid around the beach house. I was also the only kid. It's a shame I can't remember all the attention I must have received as the firstborn grandchild. Mom said half a dozen females in her extended family just loved playing with little Billy. By the early 50s, my brother Bob and I spent August at the beach house when Dad got his vacation. I'm the one with the big ears, but Dad said not to worry. Someday I'd grow into them. Mom's two sisters and their families also spent some of their vacations at the beach house, but there was always room for everyone. As the oldest grandson, I was sort of in charge of everyone having fun. That was a big responsibility that I mastered at an early age, and it has served me well ever since. Grandma seemed to be the matriarch of her family of five brothers and sisters. Many of them brought their families to the beach for parties on the weekends in the warm summers. Everyone, no matter how old or how young, no matter how distantly related, was called an aunt, an uncle, or a cousin. Grandpa was ready for the crowds. He put four large poles in the sand in front of the beach house at the beginning of the summer. Then for each family party, he put a large canvas tarp over the poles for plenty of summer shade and a lunch area. The tent, as it was called, became a well-known structure at the left end of 28th Street, and it seemed like every other weekend we'd have another beach party. I loved meeting all the relatives and trying to figure out how we were related. Some of my younger cousins say they can't remember the tent too well, but they were there. Here's a nice picture of the tent in the background and little Billy in the foreground with Uncle Doug and a few cousins. Can you guess which one is little Billy? One summer, the city got this new contraption to sift and clean the beach sand. They told Grandpa the tent poles couldn't stay up because they interfered with this monster. So he had to take the poles down, and we never saw the tent again. We quickly replaced the four tent poles with two volleyball poles, and we played a lot of family volleyball. But eventually, the city made us remove the volleyball poles too. A few years ago, the city decided it was okay to have volleyball poles, but it had to be their poles. These are the ones now at the end of 28th Street. Here's where the tent used to be. We had a lot of fun and food in that old tent. I imagine if you dig down a few feet, you'll find all sorts of treasures and a few fried chicken bones. I'll never forget the monster that ended the family tradition, so I decided to track down that awful beach cleaning contraption. This is the evil monster beach cleaner. It looks about the same as it did in the 50s, but I'm sure this is a newer model. It still prowls the beach every morning during the summer, sifting up trash and debris. It's a pretty big contraption, but it's probably still intimidated by tent poles. Never was one vehicle, intended for such a noble purpose, hated by so many. It was during our August vacations at the beach house that I met my friend Roger. Legend has it that we crawled in the sand together as our mothers drank coffee. I can't remember when I first met Roger. I can't remember when I didn't know him. So perhaps the legend is true. Whenever we met, he played on the beach every summer in the late 40s and 50s and became lifelong friends. His parents were Max and Bonnie Jean Utt. Max was a very successful attorney, and Bonnie Jean was a warm mother to Roger and his older sister, and welcomed all their friends. They lived in Glendale and had a summer home on the other side of 28th Street, just across from the beach house. Here's what it looked like in 1950. By the mid-50s, our interest had grown larger than just swimming and playing with families, and we were exploring Greater Newport Beach and all the aquatic activities. He was my constant swimming companion, body surfing and skimboarding partner, my skin diving and spearfishing buddy, and we both began surfing in 1960. He was 2 years my junior, but in every other way, my superior. He was smarter, better looking, talented, and a much better surfer. While still at Glendale High School, he and two friends started a folk singing trio, and they actually toured some military bases in Europe for the USO. Roger also went to UC Santa Barbara, and he earned a PhD in Spanish. He taught at the college level for a few years. Eventually, he moved to Spain, where he lived for 15 years, and made a monthly newsletter with an audio tape for international businessmen working in Spain. Roger died in July 2001 of cancer. Even after 50 years, my recollection of Newport Beach and Roger remain inseparable. Summers in Newport Beach were filled with activities. When we were young, they were mostly family events, but as we grew older, we created our own adventures. The first order of summer business was swimming in the relatively calm surf of the Pacific Ocean in front of the beach house. In the early 50s, Roger and I had to be watched by moms until we were deemed to be ocean safe. We would plead for an early morning swim, and one or both moms would very slowly get a beach chair, a magazine, and a cup of coffee and walk down to the ocean. The wait was agonizing. Later in the morning, before the afternoon swims, all of the cousins wanted to swim, and plenty of aunts and uncles were usually available. And you couldn't swim without making sandcastles when you wanted to take a short break. We made some pretty nice ones, and some not so nice. but no matter what kind they were, they always ended up the same way. We also collected shells. There were plenty of them if you looked around, but for some reason they were never as pretty as the ones in the shell shop. The nemesis of the beach was tar. It was a real mess when you got it on your feet, and we were repeatedly warned not to track it into the beach house. But Grandpa had a solution for almost everything. At the beach, anything that would float became a swimming toy, and we ended up with some pretty unusual toys. Even seaweed was fun to play with. We tried to make quips out of the long pieces, but it never worked out very well. We also played a lot of family volleyball. Everyone made sure there was always room to play for even the littlest cousin. Another favorite family pastime was watching TV. Grandma and Grandpa had a big screen TV for everyone to enjoy. I'm talking 32 inches. And there were a few times we went grunion hunting at night. They were fun to catch, and we'd quickly fill up a big bucket, but nobody ever wanted to cook them or eat them the next morning. Bonfires at night were also a lot of fun. In the early 50s, we'd just dig a hole in the sand and make sure everything was buried when we were done. Eventually, the city made everyone use their fire pits, but they only put one fire pit at the end of 28th Street. No bonfire was complete without marshmallows and s'mores. The s'more ingredients were simply graham crackers, chocolate bars, and those hot marshmallows. Oh, were they delicious. This is where a lot of the memories were made. This is the Pacific Ocean in front of the left end of 28th Street. All the relatives and friends that visited enjoyed the ocean activities right here. The pier is only 8 blocks down the beach. It's not very far, but it's far enough for a few kids to get lost, and I did once when I was about 6. In 1968, the Army Corps of Engineers put 8 boulder jetties on this part of the beach between the Santa Ana River and the pier to stop the sand erosion. They sort of eliminated the natural ocean view, but I guess they saved the beach. A lot of things have changed in Newport Beach in the last 50 years, but the ocean will always be the universal constant for this city. The next ocean activities were body surfing and skimboarding. Body surfing is a technique that was taught to you by your favorite uncles. Here are my professors, Uncle Art and Uncle Doug. The secret is to hook up with a wave just as it's beginning to break, and then swim like crazy to catch it and ride it to shore. It's sort of like boogie boarding without a boogie board. After a while, we became pretty good and went searching for bigger waves at 19th and 15th Streets. We were even crazy enough to go down to the famous Newport Beach Wedge by the jetty. A natural wedge is formed where the beach meets the jetty, and this causes some pretty fantastic waves for surfing. Fortunately, we only went body surfing there a couple of times. I think I'm conservative now because I cheated death so often as a youth. Skimboarding is an unusual water sport we helped to popularize. You take a thin plywood board and throw it in the shallow water as the wave is receding from shore. Then you run after the board and jump on it and skim across the water for 50 feet or so. We had to make our own skimboards because they weren't sold in stores in the late 50s. We'd buy marine plywood, bevel the edges, decorate it, and apply a half a dozen coats of marine spar varnish. Now you can buy really fancy ones. Just like body surfing, we got pretty good at it after a while. Of course, things didn't always work out as planned. It didn't take us long to enjoy some summer activities under the water. We began spearfishing as soon as we got a face mask and flippers. We made our own spears and snorkeled mostly off the beach at 28th Street. Roger's mom gave us plenty of encouragement as she offered $2 per pound for all the halibut we could spear. We had grand visions of huge halibut and lots of money to support our new hobby. But most of the time we just speared corbina. And even corbina were hard to see under the water as they blended in with the sand. But we did pretty well at spearing some nice corbina over the years. You can imagine how hard it was to see halibut under the water. Clamming was another ocean activity at which we excelled. Most people just dig for the clams at the shoreline at low tide, but real men skin dive for them just outside the breakers. Clams bury themselves in the sand with this strange-looking snorkel membrane sticking out. I guess they use it for taking in water and nutrients, but that little snorkel is hard to see without clear water and a sunny day. But on a good day, we'd quickly get more than our legal limit of clams. Some people like steamed clams, but our favorite was Uncle's fresh clam chowder. Here's a little clam cooking trivia. If you add some cornmeal to the water you boil the clams in, they will spit out the sand and eat the cornmeal before they're cooked. In the 50s, we made most of our own spears. We used long poles and hooked a spearhead on one end and tied rubber surgical tubing on the other end and then sort of stretched it like this to get a good shot. They worked pretty well. In 1960, I bought my first real spear gun, an Arbaletta, it's called. It's a little rusty, but it worked pretty well. I can count the number of fish this has speared on the fingers of one hand and have a couple of fingers left over. Don't get the wrong idea. I was a good shot. They were just small fish. And this is what we called an abalone iron. It was used to pry abalone off the rocks and also used to dig for clams. It's responsible for hundreds of clams, and its success was only limited by how long I could hold my breath. Fishing was one of the favorite summer sports. You could fish right off the sand, and we called that surf fishing. The bait of choice for surf fishing was soft-shelled sand crabs. Of course, you had to catch the crabs, and for that task, someone invented a crab catcher. We wade into the surf, and just as the wave was receding, we'd wiggle our feet in the sand to get the crabs out of the sand and into the catcher. Then we'd try to find the few soft-shell crabs among the dozens of hard-shell ones. Fishing was popular with all the uncles, and they always talked about the good old days when fish were more plentiful. Here's a picture of me having a hard time holding up some of Dad's barracuda, so he tied one end of the rope to a light pole to show them all off. Here's Uncle Art and Uncle Doug showing off some of their albacore. Sometime during the 50s, Uncle Doug got a boat, and that was the first time the cousins went fishing on a boat, and the first time I realized I got seasick. It was a small boat, but we were pretty small too. I can remember my brother Bob always playing in the bait tank. We never knew why. And there was also plenty of fishing from the pier, and we usually caught perch, mackerel, an occasional shovel-nosed shark, and a halibut if we were really lucky. You could buy a whole morning's worth of bait at Baldy's for 50 cents. Looking back at our fishing exploits, Roger and the four Robinson grandsons had a lot of fun for a long time. In fact, three quarters of the grandsons turned out to be pretty good fishermen. Here's a picture of my cousin Dick on the left, cousin Doug in the center, and my brother Bob on the right. Unfortunately, one of the grandsons still gets seasick. When he goes fishing, he usually pops a seasick pill and then just falls asleep. Surfing started to become popular in Southern California in 1950. By the late 50s, there was a transition from the long, heavy balsa wood boards to the small, light polyurethane foam boards led by a young surfboard maker named Hobie Alter. Hobie started making balsa wood boards in 1950 in his dad's garage. He opened a surf shop in Dana Point in 1954, and he continued making wood boards for four more years. After experimenting with a new polyurethane, he switched to only foam boards in January of 1958, and he became the leading supplier of foam boards, making about 250 per week. Roger and I became interested in the new sport when watching the surfers at the end of 28th Street. That was before the days of the surfboard leash, so surfers would often lose their boards and the boards would wash up on shore. We'd get the board, wade through the surf, and return it to the appreciative surfer. After a while, we'd ask them if we could take a short ride. In 1958, Bruce Brown made the first surfing documentary called Slippery When Wet. It was a great story about five surfers having a ball in Hawaii. After seeing his movie, we were absolutely hooked. Roger got his Hobie surfboard in January of 1960, probably as a gift from Santa. I got my Hobie board in the early summer of that year, after my allowance savings plus summer earnings from chores totaled $98. We surfed mostly in front of the beach house that summer and occasionally went down to the Newport Pier or to the south side of the pier at 19th Street. But the calm surf right in front of 28th Street was excellent for beginners. Now the summer of 1961 was completely different.
Let's go surfing now, everybody's learning how, come on a safari with me.
Roger and I both had summer jobs in Newport and cars, but more about that later. Roger had a surfboard rack, so he was a designated driver, and I helped with gas money at the memorable 24 cents per gallon. We tried all the surfing beaches up and down Orange County coast that summer. Huntington Beach was about as far north as we got, and it usually had pretty good surf. We tried the Santa Ana River jetty a couple of times, but it wasn't nearly as good as Huntington. The best surfing spot on Laguna was at Brook Street, but the parking was almost impossible. A little north of Dana Point was a spot called Salt Creek. It used to be hard to get to, but it's now overlooked by the Ritz-Carlton Hotel, and they have a parking lot near the beach. In Dana Point was Doheny State Beach, another great surfing spot. The city used about half of the area for the Dana Point Harbor in 1971. Further south was a spot called Trestles. It got its name because you had to park and walk under a train trestle to get into it. My favorite beach was San Onofre, which is now just north of the nuclear power plant. The surf was never too big, and there were always a lot of sociable people on the beach. My surfing adventures pretty much ended after I started college in the fall of 1961. UCSB had some good surf, but electrical engineering was a full-time sport, so I didn't bring my board. Probably just as well, because I was too timid to ever become a good surfer. Hobart Alter Jr. became famous when he invented the Hobie Cat 15, which was the most popular catamaran sailboat in history with over 100,000 sold. But to many of us, Hobie will always be remembered as the father of the foam board. This is my original surfboard. Can you imagine anyone saving a surfboard for almost 50 years? It's a 9-foot, 6-inch long, handcrafted 1960 vintage Hobie, and it hasn't been used for over 40 years. I suppose that makes it a collector's item rather than an ordinary surfboard. Anyway, my $98 investment is now worth over $1,000. I guess I ought to think about selling it someday. To Newport than ocean and family activities. There was a small town, a pier, the dory fishing fleet, a sports fishing, commercial fishing, and pleasure boat harbor, a well-known summer resort area, and wondrous adventures for a young boy. In 1951, I was an 8-year-old living in urban Whittier. My world was the 3 blocks to school and a few friends' houses. But when I came to Newport in the summers, my world seemed to expand infinitely. The sidewalk in front of the beach house led directly to the small town, only 4 blocks away. It was almost a daily ritual to walk downtown. Here is a grainy photo of the north half of the small city of Newport Beach in the early 50s. The first stop was always Henry's Candy Store. I had never seen a candy store, so it was always interesting. We didn't often buy anything, but we sure looked a lot. The next stop was a little hamburger place called Finney's. $1.50 would get you the best hamburger and malt in all of Newport. La Valley's department store was right across the street from Henry's. We usually just checked out the latest swimwear trunks. Right next to La Valley's is the location of the infamous Blackie's Bar. William Blackie Blackstone founded Blackie's by the Sea in 1953. It was always dark and quite intimidating, so we'd just peek inside. I'll never forget the sign they had in the window. Now we look at a different grainy picture of the south end of town, and here's Blackie's for reference. Henry's Candy Store moved sometime in the late 50s or early 60s, and they ended up a few doors down from Blackie's. The Al Rexall Drugstore was a favorite shop because it had a real soda fountain. I'd never seen a soda fountain before either. In the early 50s, I was interested in the Cokes. By the late 50s, I was more interested in the girls serving the Cokes. There were a couple of shell shops, but our favorite one was right here. We never figured out why they had so many beautiful shells, yet we could never find any of them in front of 28th Street. Just around the corner of the main street was Baldy's Bait Shop. We were frequent customers buying bait for fishing. Baldy's also had hooks and sinkers, and even parts for making underwater spears. A little further down the street was the Stag Bar. It had an entrance at either end of a long bar and a bunch of pool tables, so it wasn't nearly as intimidating as Blackie's. The only hardware store in town was owned by a guy named Al Forget. He had all kinds of stuff, but my uncles complained that he was always overpriced. Across the street was the famous Crab Cooker restaurant. It used to be a Bank of America and opened as the Crab Cooker in 1951. It was a popular place with probably the best fish in Newport Beach. I think it was one of the only good restaurants in the world serving food on paper plates. The famous fishing dory fleet was right here. If we got to the dory fleet early enough, we could help the arriving boats. They would drive right through the surf line and land on the beach. We'd all gather around and check out their fresh fish while we were helping pull their boats up on shore with round wooden rollers, just like they used to build the pyramids. Then we'd roll the boats right up to the area where they sold the fresh fish. Usually the last stop was the Newport Beach Pier. We'd walk out to the pier at the first area where it widened a little, just beyond the surf line. That's where we could look down at the water and see how clear it was and look for fish. We could also check out the size of the surf at 19th and 15th Streets towards Balboa. Then we'd walk out to the end of the pier and check out the fishing. There were some sinks and cutting boards for people cleaning their fish, and there was a ramp down underneath the pier where you could get really close to the ocean. This is the small city of Newport Beach today, looking from the pier. Most of the buildings are the same, but they've changed most all of the facades and stores, and they've doubled the size of the city parking lot. Here we are looking from the north end of town. Here's where Henry's Candy Store was, and they've redone most of the building into a nice hotel. At the end of the block is one of the more popular bars with the younger crowd, and it's called Mutt Lynch's. I don't know where they ever got that name. The next block towards the pier used to be a big vacant lot, but they finally built some rental apartments. The weekly rent for a small three-bedroom apartment in August is about $4,000. At the end of that block was Finney's. Here is the Finney's replacement, another hamburger place with a completely boring name of Oceanfront Burger Restaurant. Across the street from Finney's was La Valley's department store, and it's now PJ Surfriders. Right next door is the famous Blackie's by the Sea, still there after 50 years of business. They still have the old sign in the window I remember so well. Somewhere along the line, Blackie's became a gathering spot for old longboard surfers in the 60s. Every weekend, a bunch of old guys show up with their 40-year-old 10 and 12-foot boards and go surfing right in front of Blackie's. Here's some longboard surfers struggling with their boards, and a guy with one of today's short boards walking in front. You can easily see the difference in length. Henry's Candy Store is still a few doors down from Blackie's, except they've changed the name to Henry's Groceries. They have expanded their candy selection to include junk food, but it's nowhere near a real market. The Al Rexall Drugstore and Soda Fountain was a few doors down from Henry's. They've cut it up, and now it's a pizza place, a bikini boutique, and a donut shop. There probably isn't a real soda fountain anywhere in Newport now. Just across the alley in the same block was our favorite shell shop. However, they moved across the street in 1969. The whole building was made into an elegant restaurant, 21 Oceanfront, with a very nice bed and breakfast hotel upstairs. Around the corner, Baldy's Bait Store, the Stag Bar, and Alf Forget's Hardware Store are all long gone. They've been replaced by another pizza parlor, a few fast food restaurants, a swimwear store, liquor store, and a few nondescript bars. But the Crab Cooker is still across the street, and they still have some of the best seafood in Newport Beach served on paper plates. We eat there occasionally for lunch, but it's still very crowded for dinner. They've expanded a little, and here's their new annex across the street they use for storage. At the base of the pier, McFadden Square got a major facelift in 1991. The city finally tore down the disgusting public restroom and built a brand new one. Unfortunately, it soon became just as repulsive as the old one. They redid the whole area and even put in a little kiosk with an ATM, a change machine for the parking lot, and an area for advertising. For Newport's centennial anniversary this year, the city put in a new central area that was officially dedicated on July 21st, 2008. There is a very interesting world globe with a timeline of the Newport Beach history. There are five shops in McFadden Square, and here's the new location of our favorite shell shop. This is my friend Terry, the owner. He's the son of the family that started the shell shop in 1953. Just like the shell shop, Baldy's Bait Store moved across the street, but now the store just rents a lot of beach stuff. Between the shell shop and where Baldy's used to be is the real upgrade for the city, Charlie's Chili. It has the best chili cheese omelet in all of Newport Beach. The Dory Fisherman is still right next to the pier. After all, they've been there since 1891, but they've changed a lot. To begin with, it looks like they got an interior designer to make them a fancy entryway to their little fish market. On the ocean side, they added a few more interesting decorations, like a crow's nest and a sign proclaiming land ho. They used to sell the fish from the same boats they caught them in, but now they all have fancy new fishing boats, and they sell the fish from the old boats they just left in the market area. They still bait their long lines of hooks with salted anchovies, just like they did 50 years ago, but long gone are the days when people would help them land their boats. Now they just pull them out of the ocean with trucks, electric winches, and boat trailers. The Newport Pier is still the main attraction for this small town, but the city council members made some changes over the last 50 years. They were well intended, but the changes sort of diminished its old-time charm. The pier used to be covered with large wooden railroad ties, and it was always a challenge to walk to the end with bare feet and not get a splinter. Now they covered the whole pier with a cement surface. The same old wooden benches we sat on to fish are still there, but they put a tall railing all the way around the pier. It ruined the whole close-to-the-water fishing experience and that little bit of fear that you might fall in. The little platform under the pier, where you could really get close to the water, is now off-limits and protected by a chain-link fence. They replaced the small bait store and hamburger stand at the end of the pier with a fancy restaurant. Who ever heard of Newport Pier Grill and Sushi? Now you eat the bait rather than fish with it. I think my grandfather must have been a Boy Scout in his youth. I got some encouragement to become a Cub Scout in 1951. That's me towards the right, the doofus with a cap on crooked. In the fall of 1953, I became a Boy Scout with the same group of guys. I still looked like a doofus, but at least someone straightened my cap. In the summer of 1953, the Boy Scouts had their third National Jamboree at Irvine Ranch, just north of the Pacific Coast Highway in Newport Beach. Grandpa thought it would be a good idea for the two of us to go, so we drove up there and wandered around the huge campground. There were over 45,000 scouts from all over the U.S. that attended the Jamboree. I had never seen so many Boy Scouts, and I'd never been to such a huge meeting. We saw some entertainment and stayed for the meeting that evening in an enormous amphitheater. The site of the campground became Newport's famous Fashion Island. The amphitheater right next to it became the Big Canyon Country Club. They even renamed the adjacent street Jamboree Road. Fashion Island originally opened in 1967, and it went through a major enlargement in 1988. Today it has over 200 department and specialty stores in 1.3 million square feet of space. There are 40 restaurants, 3 luxury hotels, and it gets over 13 million visitors per year. Dozens of office buildings surround Fashion Island, providing space for hundreds of businesses, including a few corporate headquarters. If you walked towards the bay on 28th Street, crossed over the railroad tracks, and jogged right a little, you'd run into the blue-collar, working man's part of Newport Beach. That part of the bay had the boats and services that kept Newport Beach a commercial and sports fishing harbor and a friendly home for thousands of pleasure boats. South Coast Shipyard was the major shipyard in the area. Across the bay was Lido Shipyard, and it occupied a large portion of the Lido Peninsula. Up the channel a little was the Shock Boatyard, established in 1946. The boats in the area were mostly commercial fishing boats and bait boats, and there were also some bay dredging, and dock repair equipment. The shops in the area primarily supported the marine businesses, but there were also a few curio shops for tourists. At the north end of the channel was the Western Canners Company, a commercial fish cannery. It began business in 1934 and could can 400 cases per day of mackerel or albacore when they were in season. They added better machinery, enlarged the facility, and eventually canned 5,000 cases per day. I mentioned bait boats, and you can see one tied up in front of the cannery that I remember very well. Across the bay from the cannery was Davy's Locker, a popular sports fishing center. After the boats returned from a day of fishing, they were all lined up in front. My favorite was the Fury, because it looked so sleek. It cost $15 for fishing that left at 2 a.m. and returned at 4 that afternoon. The fishermen could trade in their fresh albacore for some canned fish at the cannery, and the rate was 1 pound of fresh fish for 1 7-ounce can. In 1958, Dad got Bob and me a small Sabot sailboat, and that blue-collar part of the bay was an ideal spot to learn to sail. It was only 8 feet long, but it was perfect for me because I was only 112 pounds. Grandpa built a little cart so I could wheel it from 28th Street to the bay. This is the way the blue-collar part of the back bay looks today. The cannery closed on August the 1st, 1966, and most of the other commercial fishing activities left the harbor. Now, this area provides the dock space for the estimated 10,000 pleasure boats and yachts in Newport Harbor. The boatyards are still here, but they have been reduced in size and now serve the maintenance and repair needs of the pleasure boats. South Coast Shipyard used to cover 2 blocks, and now it has 1 building and an outside work area. Lido Shipyard is now called Bellport Shipyard. This is the view from the other side of the bay, and you can see that it provides a lot of multi-level storage for smaller boats. Across the bay is Balboa Boatyard, with probably the prettiest sign of all of them. It used to be called Troutwine Brothers. Shock Boatyard is still up to the north end of the channel, and it seems to be doing well. The cannery was left empty for years after it was closed. Eventually, the new owner leveled it to the ground, and he built a restaurant in 1971 with almost an identical exterior. Now it's very popular, and it even has a dock in front, so you can cruise up the bay with your yacht and park it there while you have dinner. Across the bay from the cannery was Davy Locker's sports fishing fleet. They moved to the Balboa Peninsula, and now there's another nice restaurant and more slips for big yachts. Most of the buildings on the bayfront have been torn down and replaced with expensive Bayview condominiums and elite office spaces. Now the area has law offices, architects, yacht brokerages, beauty salons, upscale boutique stores, and a few small overpriced restaurants. It's ironic that the blue-collar part of Newport Beach 50 years ago now has the premium bayfront condos and small businesses. A walk to downtown Newport was almost a daily event, but we went to Balboa only a couple of times each summer. To begin with, it was about a 2-mile walk on the sidewalk from 28th Street to Balboa, and there were so many things to do and see along the way. We'd try to leave early because our goal was to have lunch on Balboa Island before the tourist crowds arrived at noon, and then get back to 28th Street for an afternoon swim. Our first stop was always 15th Street to check out the body surfing. If it looked good, we might come back there that afternoon. Then it was on to the Balboa Pier. It was never as interesting as the Newport Pier. There was a big railing all the way around it and not much fishing. But we'd go out to the end anyway, just to see if anything was happening. Then we'd cross over Balboa Boulevard to visit the pavilion. The pavilion wasn't too interesting then because there was only a restaurant and a big shell museum upstairs. So we'd go on to the Balboa Fun Zone. In the 50s, the Ferris wheel was inside the Fun Zone, right next to the merry-go-round. The bumper cars were in the building right behind the merry-go-round. We'd look at the people swimming in the bay and just do a little people watching. Then we'd visit the game arcades. Our favorite game was skee-ball because you could accumulate points and get a bigger prize. But that was saved for when the whole family came to the Fun Zone and the parents provided the tokens to play. We only had enough money for the 10-cent ferry ride across the bay and the $1.50 for lunch. The Balboa Ferry was always interesting just because of the mechanics and hooking up the ferry to the dock and getting the cars on and off. After a 5-minute ferry ride, we would arrive on the island and resume our track down the sidewalk on the bayfront. We'd turn left onto Marine Avenue, the main street of the island. We'd wander up and down Marine, looking inside some of the many tourists' traps, and then we'd finally stop at the Jolly Roger restaurant for our hamburger and malt. Then it was back to 28th Street for the afternoon swim. Today, the Balboa Pier hasn't changed much, although they changed the old pipe railing with a more decorative wooden style they used on the Newport Pier. They have a new hamburger place at the end of the pier. It's called Ruby's, and they have a pretty good hamburgers. At the base of the pier, across Balboa Boulevard, is the Balboa Pavilion. It hasn't changed much either in 50 years, nor will it, since it's now California State Historical Landmark number 959. It has a good-sized ballroom upstairs that you can rent for parties, and a couple of nice restaurants, and offices for the Balboa Bay sightseeing cruise, and the large catamaran that makes daily trips to Catalina Island. In 1965, Davy's Locker moved their sports fishing fleet to the pavilion. In the late 50s, there were 9 sports fishing fleets, and now there are only 2, Davy's Locker and Newport Landing. The Fun Zone arcades and shops for tourists have gone through a much larger transition. The pinball machines and carnival-type events have mostly been replaced by electronic games. But our old skee ball is still there, and you still accumulate tickets as you play and trade them in for prizes. The more tickets, the bigger the prize. The bumper cars are gone, but the merry-go-round is still there, although it's probably been rebuilt a dozen times in the last 50 years. And you can still get a great bay view from the top of the Ferris wheel. Except for the price, the 5-minute ferry ride to Balboa Island hasn't changed much either. It's now $1 per person and $2 per car, but it's still a fun experience. In the good old days, the ferry captain steered the ferry from a small stand with a steering wheel on each side depending on which way the ferry was going. Now he has a fancy enclosed little cabin. He's probably got air conditioning and a GPS in there too. This is what Marine Avenue looks like today, and it's still lined with the towering eucalyptus trees. Except for Hershey's Market, which started in 1929, most of the curio shops and tourist traps on Main Street were probably new in the last 50 years. The old Jolly Rogers is now Wilma's Patio. I haven't tried their hamburgers, but they have a great chili size. My first real job was at Richards Lido Market at the entrance to Lido Island. Dick Richards opened his market in 1948, and it was to become the most upscale market in Newport Beach. No one ever thought he'd survive with his high prices, but he made $1 million in his first year. I was 18 when I got the job there in 1961. I had just graduated from high school, and I needed all the spending money I could earn for college. I got a car just before Easter, but parking spots were hard to get during the busy summer months on 28th Street, so I just leave my car in front of the beach house and walk the few blocks to Richards Market. Roger and I applied for summer jobs at about the same time, but somehow he got the prestige job as a box boy, and I got a job as a busboy and dishwasher in their small coffee shop. But I had a lot of fun. Towards the end of the summer, we tried offering a small selection of dinners for late-night shoppers. My boss created a simple dinner menu with just a few entrees. Then we added some tablecloths to make the coffee shop look like a real restaurant, and we even hired a waitress. My memories are more about the new waitress than the dinners we served. Her name was Marilyn Beebe, and I'll never forget her. Dick Richards died in 1979, and the market became a Pavilions. This is what it looks like today. My little coffee shop was eliminated when Pavilion enlarged their store during a remodel. They didn't need a coffee shop anymore because a few restaurants had opened nearby. They've tried to maintain the upscale image of the old Richards Market with a good and expensive collection of meats, fish, and organic produce. I went inside and asked the store manager if he had any pictures of the old Richards, and he asked me, who was Richard? The Rendezvous Ballroom is located at the base of the Balboa Pier. It had been a popular dance hall for the big bands of the 40s and early 50s. I didn't know that in the summer of 1961, when I first became aware of the Rendezvous. A few local surfers were talking about a new kind of music. They called it surf music, and a guy named Dick Dale. After playing at smaller places in Balboa, Dick Dale and the Deltones opened at the Rendezvous Ballroom on July 14th, 1961, to about 20 people. His music caught on with a local crowd, and the July average attendance for his weekend shows grew to 187. In August, he averaged 317 per show, and that's when Roger and I first saw him. By 1962, he was playing to thousands of surf music fans every weekend. Dick became friends with Leo Fender, by far the most famous developer of the electric guitar. Leo gave him one of his new Stratocaster guitars that soon became known as the Beast because of the unusual way Dick played it. Leo also gave him one of his most powerful amplifiers and said, "Beat it to death." According to Dick's website, that's exactly what he did, and he blew out dozens of Leo's amplifiers and speakers, with some of them actually catching on fire. So Leo finally visited the Rendezvous ballroom to see what Dick was really doing, and realized he had to design even more powerful amplifiers. Leo contacted the Triad Transformer Company and told him he had to have a more powerful audio transformer. Then he had Altec Lansing redesign their 15-inch, 85-watt D130 speaker. They called it the D130F for Fender. Leo redesigned his amplifier, calling it the Dual Showman, and he put two D130F speakers in the case for 170 watts of power. Then Dick Dale used two Showman amplifiers. I can't remember too much about the Rendezvous in 1961, but it sure was loud. Dick released four singles in 1961, and his first album, Surfer's Choice, was released in April of 1962. Finally, the rest of the world started learning about Dick Dale. In 1963, he released King of the Surf Guitar. He said he got his inspiration for a lot of his music from surfing. Let's go tripping means let's go surfing. Apparently, he was a pretty good surfer, and he and his girlfriend surfed mostly in South Orange County. His popularity led to roles in three of the Beach Party movies, starring Annette Funicello and Frankie Avalon. Dick is the not-too-happy one towards the left. Surf music seemed to be taking over Southern California with many new bands. The Safaris in 1962. The Shantays in 1963. The Ventures in 1964. The multi-part harmony Beach Boys. Even though the Beach Boys stayed popular for over 50 years, surf music sort of faded by the mid-60s as the world became totally preoccupied with another group.
One, two, three, five!
Of course, I love the Beatles, but I'll always remember Dick Dale and the Rendezvous Ballroom. The old Rendezvous burned down on August the 7th, 1966, and they never rebuilt that famous part of history. I guess that's okay, because I'll always remember when and where surf music began. I saw it all at the Rendezvous Ballroom in the summer of 1961. In 2005, a company called Sundays re-released Dick's 1989 CD, and I went to see him at a Virgin Records signing event. I stood in line for a half hour just to shake the hand of the King of the Surf Guitar. Here's the site of the old Rendezvous. After the fire, they built some nice condominiums, but they only have a view of the Balboa parking lot. I suppose if you're on the top floor, you can see the ocean and the Balboa Pier. Since the Rendezvous was such a historical building, Orange County put this plaque on the site. The last line reads, "The music and dancing have ended, but the memories linger on." Thanks for joining me on our little tour of Newport in the 50s. As I said at the beginning, it will live in the hearts and minds of those who were there. And that's a good thing, because as we've seen, physical history is fragile. To my extended family members, I'm sorry I didn't include more stuff about the family. But as Vince Lombardi once said, when his Packers football team lost, we just ran out of time. To my other friends, I'm sorry there was so much junk in there about a bunch of people you never knew. But I hope you found my memories of Newport Beach interesting. And to everyone, enjoy your memories and have a wonderful life making them.
Sweet, sweet memories you gave of me. You can't beat the memories you gave of me.
Take one fresh and tender kiss.
The memories you gave of me.
Add one stolen night of bliss.
You can't beat the memories you gave of me.
One girl, one boy, some grief, some joy, memories are made of this. Don't forget a small moonbeam. Fold in lightly with a dream. Your lips and mine, two sips of wine. Memories are made of this.
Can't beat the memories you gave me. Then add the wedding bells, one house where lovers dwell, three little kids for the flavor. Stir carefully through the days, see how the flavor stays. These are the dreams you will savor.
With
sweet, sweet,
his blessings
you gave
from
me.
Above,
you can't beat the memories you gave of me.
Serve
sweet, sweet,
it generously with love.
You can't beat the memories you gave of me.
One man, one wife, one love through life.
Sweet, sweet,
memories are made of this.
Can't